genocide is not a word the U.S. government throws around too easily or too frequently and without a lot of deliberation and planning and research and discussion. Genocide is not a word that anybody should throw around too easily, frequently, or without a lot of planning and thinking and research and discussion. But genocide is a term that the U.S. government has decided to use to describe what is going on in areas under ISIS control. And genocide is what brings us together here today to discuss what can be done, what has been done, what can be done to improve our capacity to protect people. People facing genocide. I'll remind you that on March 17th, Secretary of State Kerry declared that the Islamic State, quote, is responsible for genocide against groups and areas under its control, including Yazidis, Christians, and Shiite Muslims. Now, of course, it's not solely up to the United States to roll back the Islamic State, nor is it solely up to the United States to protect all civilians facing the onslaught of genocide. But we do have a certain measure of responsibility, and we have a certain capability to act. And it's that combination of the fact that genocide is presenting itself, the fact that we have a measure of responsibility, and the fact that we have some capability. Put all those things together, and we're here today to see what more can be done. I'm delighted that for this special event, we are hosting this in conjunction with the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum, which is rather exceptional for us at the Washington Institute, since by tradition, we don't organize events with other institutions, but the Holocaust Museum is a special institution with a special status and a special mission, and genocide is not our everyday topic. And so I'm very proud that we can host this event and proud that we have a panel of such outstanding experts, all of whom have firsthand personal knowledge, expertise, and experience to bring to bear on this important topic. Speaking first will be my colleague Matt Levitt. Matt is the director of our Fromer Wexler Fellow and director of our Stein Program on Counterterrorism and Intelligence here at the Institute. He served previously in the FBI, in the Treasury Department, and brings great insight into what is going on in the battle against ISIS and what more can be done in this effort. Speaking second will be Naomi Kikoler. Naomi is the Deputy Director of the Simon-Skjodt Center for Prevention of Genocide at the Holocaust Museum. Previously, she worked as Director of Policy and Advocacy at the Global Center for Responsibility to Protect and as a legal fellow at the Amnesty International of Canada. Naomi will bring special observations from a field visit that was made under the auspices of the Holocaust Museum to provide firsthand testimony and evidence that helped lead to the determination of genocide. And speaking third is my colleague here at the Institute, Ambassador Jim Jeffrey, the Philip Solondz Distinguished Fellow at the Institute, who served formally as American ambassador to both Iraq and Turkey. Jim has decades of experience in many different facets of dealing with the issue of civilian protection, going all the way back to his army service in Vietnam. And so with this panel today, I hope that we can shed light not only on what is happening, but on what we can do more to help prevent any more human suffering in the territory that is controlled by ISIS, and hope to bring as speedy as possible a conclusion to the horror of genocide occurring there. Matt, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Rob. Thank you all for joining us today. I'm especially pleased to share the podium not only with you, Rob, but of course with Naomi and with Jim. The Holocaust Museum deserves a tremendous amount of credit for putting this issue on the map, and I think a tremendous amount of credit for the State Department taking this on and actually making the determination that it did. Before we get to what to do about it, I think it's still important to lay out the scope of the problem because it's not going away. This is part of the DNA of what the Islamic State is, what it's all about. We could have and maybe should have anticipated this from the get-go, but we are where we are, and as we look at their ideology, what they say, what they do, what they have done, we have to appreciate the fact that there is an incredible need not only to document the atrocities that have happened, but to think about how to change the way we go about business to prevent further atrocities from happening in the future. The Islamic State adheres to a hardline Salafi jihadi ideology, which is overlaid with an apocalyptic end of times worldview, pitting true believers, as they see true believers, against everybody else. And in this black and white worldview, it's not just permissible to kill enemies and unbelievers, it is a religious duty to do so. For example, the Islamic State classified Shia, Alawites, as apostates, meaning they are summarily subject to punishment by death. And they've talked about this quite openly. In the seventh issue of the Islamic State's glossy propaganda magazine, Dabiq, which they entitled From Hypocrisy to Apostasy, The Extinction of the Gray Zone, the group reveals its polarized worldview. They see the battle between faith and disbelief as, quote, a binary test of Muslim faith. And the group stubbornly denies any chance of peaceful existence with people who hold different beliefs, including Muslim beliefs different than their own. In an earlier version of Dabiq magazine, number 4, the Islamic State focused on the Yazidi minority, concluding that Yazidi women could be enslaved and determining that the group's vision for dealing with polytheists would apply to Yazidis. They wrote, kill the polytheists wherever you find them, capture them, and besiege them. But if they should repent, establish prayer, and give zakah, let them go, except that that wasn't the case in what they actually did. While the Islamic State claims to be defending its territory, its idea of, quote, defense includes attacking, killing, raping, or enslaving Syrians and Iraqis who do not share its beliefs or who resist in any way, according to a unclassified Dutch intelligence report that is available online through the AIVD in multiple languages, including English. Violence, the Dutch report concluded, and I quote, is preached, glorified, and used on a daily basis. And this violence is widely known to potential Islamic State recruits prior to their arrival in Syria and Iraq. The report continues, and again I quote, anyone traveling to the so-called Islamic State is knowingly opting to join a terrorist group which regards all outsiders as infidels and uses excessive violence on a daily basis. Everyone who has traveled since 2014 to the area under the group's control will have seen the propaganda images of atrocities against, quote, non-believers, scenes of bloody executions and young children in military training camps, along with euphoric video compilations of terrorist attacks claimed by the Islamic State, which circulate daily amongst jihadist circles and are easy to find on the internet. Most of those who leave have been told beforehand by their contacts in Syria that they will be trained for and sent into combat, end quote. This is all part of the Islamic State's plan. When the group established its so-called caliphate, it was part of a grand strategy to force Muslims into choosing between the Islamic State's version of Islam or being an apostate. And they write in Dabiq, the mujahideen in the land of jihad will find themselves driven to join the ranks of the caliphate or forced to wage war against it on the side of those willing to cooperate with the hypocrites and the apostates against the caliphate. If they do not execute these treacherous orders, they will be considered extremists by their leaders and face the sort of quote-unquote independent courts infiltrated by the Sunnis and Ikhwan and other sects. And here's the important part. Eventually, they write in Dabiq, the gray zone will become extinct and there will be no place for grayish calls and movements. There will be only the camp of faith, their version of faith, and the camp of kufr. The concept of the gray zone fits perfectly into the Islamic State's overall narrative, that a Muslim cannot and will not ever be accepted into the West, that they cannot live a normal, integrated life in Europe or America or elsewhere. Instead, what the Islamic State wants to do is convince Muslims that Europe will never accept them and that every shooting and bombing and beheading has this goal in mind. By declaring their caliphate, the Islamic State believes it has forced the decision of choosing us or them on Muslims everywhere. And they've gone so far as to offer rewards for killing imams who speak out against the Islamic State's efforts to force Muslims to choose this binary choice between, as they put it, caliphate and apostates. And to further this objective, they engage in ultra-violence as part of not only how they do what they do, but who and what they are. The Islamic State is known for its wanton, barbaric violence and has often employed such violence as a means to instill fear in and subjugate groups of people. It's a brutal tactic that has often worked in ways beyond the Islamic State's imagination and intention, such as during the Iraq War when local people were actually driven towards the American army due to the Islamic State's unnecessary brutality. But ultraviolence did work in its favor as well. For example, Islamic State knew that extreme violence attracted eyeballs to propaganda, as they put it, and would soon become masters at recording executions of all kinds for mass consumption via distribution across multiple social media platforms. These videos have become a key piece to their online recruitment and fundraising processes. The reasons the Islamic State employs such a tendency towards ultraviolence can be traced back to many sources, but one of them would be their interpretation of the Al-Qaeda manual, The Management of Savagery, and their own strategic plan, which similarly to the Al-Qaeda manual, would serve as a guide to governing territory and to ruling. According to the Management of Savagery, conquering and controlling territory would take nothing short of, quote, ceaseless, uncompromising violence, end quote. The manual goes on to further argue that ultraviolence serves as the best deterrent and can make the enemy think 1,000 times before attacking you. It even argued that targeting the children and women of the enemy is allowed as long as it deters the enemy from targeting their own women and children in response. The Islamic State's ultraviolence, its crimes against humanity, its war crimes, its genocidal actions all play into the group's overall apocalyptic vision. The Islamic State uses an end-of-days ideology to justify all of these barbaric acts, including slavery, which, though sanctioned by the Quran, the Islamic State blatantly celebrates when it captures and sells Yazidis as sex slaves to its fighters, as it did, for example, back in the fall of 2014. It's also hailed the return of slavery as one of the signs of the days of judgment. It should no longer come as any surprise the Islamic State will carry out these horrific inhumane attacks in the name of their apocalyptic vision and goal of eliminating the so-called gray zone. And there is plenty of past precedent, and Naomi will get into some, to demonstrate that they have done just this. The UN's Independent International Commission of Inquiry on the Syrian Arab Republic has also documented many such cases. The assault on the Tapka air base and the beheadings and summary executions that followed. In short, the UN concludes in one of its reports, and again I quote, "In areas it controls, the Islamic State has continued to torture and ill-treat civilians and captured fighters from other armed groups and government soldiers. This conduct has been documented in 3 distinct contexts: public punishments for breaches of Islamic State edicts in the group's detention centers and during its indoctrination efforts." What stuck with me from that quote is the fact that this has been documented. Whatever context, it's been documented. It hasn't been documented enough because we haven't invested what is not actually a terribly large investment in putting together the resources to send people in behind the military into liberated areas to document what's happened. Maybe even to think about what areas need to be liberated earlier than others so as to protect civilians. We do have a responsibility to protect. It's not just words. And since we know who we're dealing with, and since we are fortunate right now to be seeing them suffer battlefield defeat, we should be incorporating this not only into how we react after territories have been liberated, but maybe also into which territories need to be liberated first. Thank you.
Thank you, Matt.
Thank you very much. And I would really like to thank Rob and his whole team for co-hosting this incredibly important and timely conversation that we're having today. I'm going to share a little bit from the perspective of the Simon-Skjodt Center for the Prevention of Genocide at the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum, our findings from the work that we've been doing on Iraq, and outline a couple of areas where we think we could see a greater kind of emphasis on atrocity prevention in the current counter-ISIL strategy. For a quick background, I traveled to northern Iraq to interview members of minority communities that were either living under the control of the Islamic State or fled in anticipation of the Islamic State advance. And in the course of those conversations, as Rob and Matt have both noted, it became sadly very, very clear that genocide and crimes against humanity and ethnic cleansing had been perpetrated by the Islamic State, which led to our finding that the Islamic State is not just a terrorist organization, it's also a genocidal organization. And we need to be addressing it as a genocidal organization that preys on civilians as one of its strategic purposes. Just for a quick background, over the course of 3 months between June to August of 2014, the Islamic State attacked communities in Nineveh, which is a northern province in Iraq. 800,000 people were driven from their homes, of which half of that population were members of religious and ethnic minorities. They effectively managed to drive the entire community out of northern Iraq, out of Nineveh, and into displacement, with most people leaving and seeking shelter under areas controlled by the Kurdish regional government. 10% of Nineveh's population were minorities. The province is a Sunni majority province. In the interviews that we did, we found that there had been the intentional targeting by the Islamic State of particular communities for genocide. We learned also that genocide is ongoing. And I'll give you one particular example of a man by the name of Salem. Salem is Yazidi. And when I met with Salem, he documented for me 52 family members that were missing, either presumed to be killed or kidnapped. Of that, 17 were women. And his understanding was the majority of those women were still being held as sex slaves by the Islamic State. And for that purpose, we've been very clear to say that genocide is actually still happening today in regard to the women and children that are being held. I spoke with a principal. His entire, one entire class of 30 young boys have been kidnapped, 9-year-olds, for the purpose of being trained to become fighters for the Islamic State. And they were being held in Syria. We also, though, in the report, wanted to underscore that all Iraqis, irrespective of their religious background, are facing very serious security threats, especially those posed by the Islamic State, and we need to be talking and addressing those as well. In regards to some of the key things that I think we need to keep in mind for this particular conversation, the risks posed by the Islamic State continue and persist, and I'll highlight what some of those risks are. But there is right now a really crucial need for our conversation when we talk about how to counter ISIL to focus on the day after. And the day after includes conversations about stabilizing newly liberated areas, how to provide security and safety to local populations. That is critical to ensuring the legitimacy and credibility of the counter ISIL strategies, but more importantly, it's critical to their efficacy. And I'll go into a couple of reasons why that's the case. We need to be putting atrocity prevention, the prevention of the very crimes that we documented, squarely within the national security conversation. To do that, it requires innovation. It doesn't necessarily require an abundance of new resources, but it does require leadership. And I want to commend those in the room who are working right now to do that. Atrocity prevention and counterterrorism are mutually reinforcing end goals, and they need to be regarded as being, atrocity prevention needs to be regarded as being central to the counter-ISIL strategy and the efforts that are being undertaken. What are some of the things that emerged from the interviews that we did, and why is it so important from our perspective to look at what the local threats are? What are the needs of local communities? In the course of the interviews, what emerged was that clearly the perpetrators are actually very diverse. Those that were committing genocide, ethnic cleansing, war crimes included people who were fighters for the Islamic State, local foreign fighters. They included neighbors who were complicit. They included neighbors who decided to be opportunistic in supporting massacres that were being perpetrated by the Islamic State. We need to understand those dynamics to understand what is motivating perpetrators and those who are enabling and aiding and abetting the commission of these crimes. Their diverse motivations suggest strategies through which we could potentially prevent the recurrence of these types of atrocities. And one thing that I found really striking, especially in interviewing survivors of a particular massacre, was that one of the reasons that the massacre, which appeared impending at certain points, was delayed for a number of days, was because of key relationships that a particular community leader had with senior Ba'athist officials in Mosul. As you begin to talk more and more with these local communities and really look at it from the perspective of what are the threats they face, you realize, again, the diverse nature of the perpetrators and the diverse motivations that are influencing them to commit crimes. But having said that, I think a stark takeaway is that the Islamic State is committing atrocity crimes for a very strategic purpose, to either control a population, expel populations from areas that are under control, or to exterminate populations. And the reasons for doing that differ based on where geographically they were moving in Nineveh and which were the communities that they were encountering. One of the other things that emerged in terms of the conversation that's relevant to how do we combat the Islamic State today and prevent atrocities is, again, the importance of intelligence gathering and intelligence sharing. I've just highlighted a couple of examples in terms of mining local communities to understand the vulnerabilities that they have, to identify the gaps that might exist in their protection strategies. You know, if we take a look at the Christian community, for example, for 10 years, Christians had been fleeing Iraq. In large part, that's because it was really the only protection strategy that this particular community had available to it. But in terms of intelligence, it also means ensuring that available intelligence that is being gathered by, be it special forces, other forces on the ground, are shared with various stakeholders in the State Department, but also others, to ensure that they can develop strategies in this kind of stabilization, post-liberation phase that will protect local minorities. In a practical sense, what does that mean? That means ensuring that we can actually get satellite imagery that identifies where mass graves are located in a timely manner, that we can do mapping exercises of where vulnerable communities currently reside, where were their homes originally, what are the opportunities for them to return home. There's a whole host of ways in which we should be examining and interrogating how we're gathering intelligence, how we're sharing intelligence, and how we're using it for the purpose of civilian protection. In terms of talking about the strategies for protecting these communities, it's really important, and it's one of the points that we underscore in the report, that the way the Islamic State is fought and countered will have a determining impact on whether or not Iraq is going to see future atrocities. And in saying that, I just want to highlight that one of our major findings was that there was a serious failure to prevent the crimes perpetrated by the Islamic State and a failure to protect these communities. We focused specifically on minority communities that were targeted on the basis of their identity. These are communities that have simply not been a priority to pretty much anyone, which is sad to say. These are communities where the threats that they were facing for over 10 years were clearly documented. And in the case of Nineveh, and again, I'll explain in a second the focus and the emphasis on Nineveh, they were communities where we had seen attacks by Sunni and Shia extremists for over a decade. We had seen rising Sunni extremism within Nineveh. We had seen the lack of protection strategies for these particular minority communities. And we had also seen the rise of the Islamic State that posed a threat to them. Yet at numerous points in which we could have taken those warning signs and developed strategies, and when I say we, I mean the international community, I mean the government of Iraq, I mean the Kurdish regional government that had control or exercised control over certain parts of that territory, to develop a strategy to prevent and protect these particular communities. And I think we have to, in the future, in developing a strategy, be much more attuned to the early warning signs and develop the early action that could help to protect these particular communities. In regards to the future risks that we see, I've highlighted already that there are women and children that continue to be held by the Islamic State. Unfortunately, some of the accounts that we've heard from those who've got family members that are still being held suggest that some of these women may be now moving to, are being moved to Mosul. In the course of the interviews that I did, there was a lot of discussion and concern about the use of civilians as human shields in Mosul and what the potential risks could be in any effort to liberate that particular area. We've highlighted concerns about the unintended consequences of some of the counter-ISIL strategy, including those pertaining to the conduct of the hostilities. In that regard, some things that stand out are the potential and risks associated with possible reprisal killings, the risks associated with efforts to perhaps do a reversal of the kind of forced Arabization process that Saddam Hussein had and others had enforced, so prohibiting Sunni Arabs from returning to areas that they've lived, concerns about weapons flows and the use of those weapons, and risks around collateral damage are all risks associated with the conduct of hostilities that will pose potentially future risks to civilians. But the main part that we're really focusing on is these protection gaps in the liberated areas and what needs to be done immediately to try to ensure that there can be a safe return for populations, that there can be reconciliation between communities of which there is immense distrust today amongst them, and to ensure that we don't see future vulnerabilities emerge. And in that, I just want to highlight very quickly one issue which contributed to, in our minds, the exacerbation of vulnerabilities by these particular minority communities. And that is the fact that these communities resided in a part of Iraq that is disputed. And that is something that continues to persist as being a serious problem. And that's one of the reasons that we wanted our report to really focus on the unique threats that these communities face. Just for very quick background, much of Nineveh is disputed in terms of its territorial control between the government of Iraq and the Kurdish regional government. In the report, we go into greater detail about what that meant in terms of the failure to prevent things like intelligence sharing between the two entities, but also the failure to protect in terms of actual physical protection when the Islamic State came to the actual communities. In both cases, the communities themselves felt they had been abandoned. But today, the disputed status is continuing to be a impediment in some regards to action. In one area that we focus on, which is the need for accountability and investigation, there are a whole host of questions about how do we get on the ground individuals who are capable of doing the investigation, who has to give the authorization to allow for that to happen. Is it the government of Iraq? Is it the KRG? Who takes the leadership on prosecuting Islamic State fighters? But we need to resolve the disputed status of these minorities because these minorities feel vulnerable. They feel very much as though they are potentially at risk and at prey for future atrocities by what they see as being the next iteration of the Islamic State that is in waiting. And we can, in the kind of question and answers, go into what that means in terms of providing legal protection, physical protection, political protection to these particular minority groups, which is so critical to preventing future atrocities. Maybe I'll just end by quickly highlighting again, you know, for us, the protection of minorities must, and the protection of civilians more broadly from mass atrocity crimes, must lay at the center of the counter-ISIL strategy. It's mutually reinforcing to advance the goals of the counter-ISIS strategy. If we aren't protecting these particular communities and we're allowing these atrocities to happen, we will see a future in Iraq where these minority communities will be unable to return, or where you will see, not just amongst the minority communities, but others, people resorting again to the use of arms to settle disputes, to seek justice through a military response. And that's something that we simply can't allow to happen at this particular point. So I'm just going to end by saying that Secretary of State Kerry, his acknowledgement that genocide had happened is significant. And it has to mean something for communities and populations in Iraq. The challenge right now is how to provide protection to those communities and ensure that we don't see a recurrence of atrocities again. And as a result, we need to be thinking very carefully about how to put civilians, local populations, at the center of our efforts to counter the Islamic State. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, Rob, Matt, Naomi. It's a pleasure being up here today. It's a pleasure seeing so many of you because this is such an important theme, and it's something that faces us directly today with ISIS, but it's been facing us for many years. throughout the 20th century and clearly well into this century and beyond. What I'd like to do is to talk a bit about some general rules of the road that I've experienced in my time either on the ground or backstopping one or another operation related to all of this. And secondly, some very general ideas to sketch out on how to go about this with ISIS, although Naomi and Matt have already pointed the direction here. First, some definitions, because this is always complicated. It's a sliding scale between going in to prevent genocide, because it's been formally defined as genocide, all the way up or down to trying to protect vulnerable populations who may or may not be actively under attack but are at risk of doing so. Essentially, there are two, and the one thing that's common in all of this is a combat or on the verge of combat situation and a humanitarian imperative. That, to me, defines a humanitarian intervention as opposed to a realpolitik intervention for classic political, diplomatic, or security purposes. And the two categories, of course, overlap. Even a pure geopolitical intervention, say Kuwait in 1990-1991, involved, because it always does when there's military action of any dimension, an at-risk population, in this case the Kuwaiti population, and then it turned out the civilian population of the Shia areas of southern Iraq. Likewise, humanitarian interventions, no matter how pure, and the purest I can think of in the recent past was our intervention in Libya, have one or another degree of geopolitical dimension to it, if only the way the various countries that go in and intervene related to each other, what their goals were, the role of the institutions, NATO, UN, and some of the after effects of it, including the rise of an ISIS presence. So you can't totally separate the two. But it's easy to separate the two, humanitarian interventions and geopolitical or realpolitik interventions, than it is to try within humanitarian interventions to say, well, that's a genocide that's already underway, or this is a genocide that might happen, or this is simply, you know, a random but very nasty killing of civilians. So we'll stick to humanitarian military interventions and focus on what works and what doesn't. Well, first of all, why is this a problem? This should be self-evident. We, the West, or the organized community, the UN, have extraordinary resources, and we're all pained and troubled and shaken by the discriminate and mass use of violence against civilian populations for political or ideological or other ends. So why is it even a question of debating whether we should go in? And the reason is because often these things have not worked out very well. Think of Beirut in 1983, Somalia in the early 1990s, to some degree Iraq after we had taken down the government. We had a huge humanitarian and quasi-civil war situation where the population was being targeted by at least two separate groups. Afghanistan, the very vulnerable population there, and Libya. In all of these cases, the United States and other elements of the international community lost support at home because these things dragged on. Thus, a fear of quagmire, mission creep, in short, casualties among our own forces, and the resulting decline in popular support at home, in part because the American people or the British people or you name the country do not see what's in it for us. What are we gaining out of this? Okay, we stopped a lot of killing, but what's going to happen next? And now we've stopped a lot of killing of civilians we don't know, but now we're getting people coming home in body bags. Why should we like this situation? And we know how voters react. But it can work. We saw it work in Bosnia, in Kosovo. Along the Green Line, Naomi talked about the disputed territories. What we did was we put 22 American platoons. That's if everybody was present for duty and wasn't sick with, fever or anything. That's about 600 troops. Strategically, along about a 800-kilometer border, and that was enough to keep the Kurdish and Iraqi army forces from going at it, leading to heavy casualties among themselves and the populations, which were heavily mixed in those disputed areas. It worked in Anbar province of Iraq in 2007-2008, when much of the population shifted to our side, as Ben's mentioned, and we're able to work with these people from the population, mainly having them protect their own fellow villagers, relatives from al-Qaeda terrorists, the precursors of ISIS, in fact. So what works and what doesn't generally? First of all, the more you can give something an international imprimatur, the better. That normally means the UN, but in the case of the Green Line in Iraq, it meant an outside somebody, in this case the United States. We were accepted by both the Iraqi government and the Kurdistan Regional Government. So international essentially equals legitimacy and acceptance. Monopoly of force is very important. When NATO went into Bosnia at the end of the bombing campaign, it went in heavy with 60,000 troops. That was one soldier for every 50 Bosnians at the time. That ensures a monopoly of force, or close to it. Secondly, you have to integrate the effort to protect the population against violence with other efforts to bring relief. And that seems to be common sense, but it requires an awful lot of integration and effort. And now I'm going to be contradictory because a lot of this stuff is yin and yang, plus and minus. You have to have an end game out there, or countries, particularly democratic countries, will not allow their foot soldiers to go in. But you have to separate the end game, which is necessarily a political process and often a realpolitik, a geopolitical process, which means that inside a country or an area and in a region and internationally, there are winners and losers. And typically the losers respond, or they're tempted to respond, with violence, thus bringing you back to the initial problem of trying to protect populations, because the violence is usually directly or indirectly against the populations. You have to separate the end game from the effort. Many of the mistakes we've made is in when the United States has gone in largely for humanitarian purposes, Somalia and particularly Beirut, we start developing geopolitical endgames that create enemies when we didn't have them initially. Those enemies start shooting at our people, and you know the result in both of those cases and many others. In that regard, this is something that we worked on very, very closely, and it was very, very confrontational in Bosnia, but I think it was the right decision, and that is you have to be very careful with trying to establish accountability for war crimes and for genocide and for the massacre of civilians from the effort to secure an area. This was a huge issue for Dick Holbrooke, and as he's not here anymore, and as I happen to support his position, I'll draw on him as an example. He was very reluctant to put pursuit of war crimes at the center of our efforts when we did put our NATO troops in 1995, because he felt that those people who we were pursuing or prosecuting, and their friends, allies, cousins, and others, would see this as a political challenge to them, and they would respond by opening up hostilities again. So while you have to do that, and I think that the Balkans is a good example, in fact, the process is still going on today, that has to be separated from and subordinate to the initial establishment of a monopoly of force and the protection of civilians. Or you're going to be protecting the civilians, again, from the people who were accused of previously conducting war crimes against them. Empower locals. Again, we have the example of situation in Anbar province with the awakening. And finally, be very sure that you're not in there indefinitely. That gets to the end game. Okay, now, to get to ISIS, a couple of points. First of all, you're dealing with not one but three separate conflicts that are primarily targeting civilians. The ISIS one in the center, which we're going to focus on right now, and an even larger assault on civilians perpetrated by the Syrian government and its friends, and these two areas overlap. And thirdly, in Iraq, a much smaller but still worrisome quasi-remnants of a civil conflict that is perpetuated by some of the Shia militias moving into Sunni areas, and to a lesser degree, but it still has to be watched, again, as Naomi said, tensions between Kurdish forces in populations and Arab forces in populations. So it's a very complicated picture. But to focus on ISIS, while bearing in mind that it's not the only problem you're going to deal with out there, once again, it's both moving into areas in part out of justification to protect those civilians who are under the thrall of ISIS. These people are under the worst of human rights abuses and persecution, and it is a goal in and of itself. There are many other goals and many other rationales for going after ISIS, but trying to liberate the millions of people that are under their control is a humanitarian goal worthy in and of itself. So it's both moving into areas militarily to drive out ISIS and to thus protect the population. Secondly, even in areas that have been, quote, liberated from ISIS, and we see this all the time around in Anbar and around Baghdad, the job isn't done because ISIS is capable of infiltrating terrorists, suicide bombers, and frankly, retaking territory. We've seen that several times. So it's very necessary to establish a monopoly of force, as I said. That should not be U.S. forces. I'm a skeptic about not using U.S. forces to take down major ISIS areas because I don't think anybody else is going to do it. But I'm equally skeptical about keeping U.S. forces on in large numbers because they will attract geopolitical hostility. They will attract the classic fear of colonial domination hostility, and the list goes on and on. That said, while you should rely mainly on local forces and on the two governments, and I'll get to that in a second, you have to some degree, have some U.S. personnel on the ground for several reasons. Let me start with the two governments. In the case of Iraq, for all of its sins and problems, it provides some kind of government that if we, and particularly the international community, if you could get the UN in, or if you could get even the GCC in, or the OIC in, some organization that it could be answerable to, it's capable of keeping its Shia militias under control and dealing with the population. We've seen some fairly good news in Tikrit. And we've seen some bad news in areas to the east in Diyala. So it's capable of doing that, but it requires a lot of help. The Syrian government is probably not capable of moving into Sunni areas where much of the population has been in rebellion against it and dealing with that population in any kind of decent humanitarian way. So that's a real problem. We haven't solved that solution yet. Again, the emphasis should be on local people with an international imprimatur. What's the role of the United States? Several. Aside from behind the scenes making much of this happen, as we do around the world on many things, it's to provide logistics, advisory teams, and air support. It doesn't take first-class troops to protect an area from ISIS. We've seen that repeatedly in Iraq and in parts of Syria. It does help a hell of a lot, though, to have U.S. air power on call. That's really important, and it helps even more to have U.S. advisory teams, forward air controllers, and other things. There's been a reluctance in this administration to do that. I think that it's a lot easier to get them to change their mind on that than it is to put whole brigades of troops in. And they seem to be moving in that direction. Let's hope so. On the other hand, there's a benefit to having some American troops on the ground in any case because, and I don't want to push this too far because I would argue the opposite over the long term, they're seen often in crisis or immediate post-crisis situations as an objective balancing force because American forces can work with everybody. They also have pretty good entree through the State Department and the interagency system here into the political and international sides. So that would be very important too, but again, it's tricky because you can't keep troops on for very long or you generate problems. The other thing is American troops bring in a very, very stringent rules of engagement in the sense of, while they're very careful about collateral damage, the force protection requirements are such that they often alienate a population. So while it keeps our own casualties down, it often keeps civilian casualties down, it does so by creating a huge political problem with the local population. So there are several problems with having American forces in. Again, you have to combine this with the relief efforts, which are going to have to be major, and certainly the Iraqi government, let alone the Syrian government, can't take care of that. You're going to have a longer-term solution to this, but this can be done. It has been done before, and it needs to be done, and as long as we just sit there and watch what's happening to millions of people without acting, we're going to be held responsible. Thank you.
Very good. Jim, thank you very much. You touched on, in passing, an issue I just wanted to mention at the outset of the Q&A session, which is today's discussion is focused on what can be done to address the genocide being perpetrated by the Islamic State and our responsibility, our capabilities, what we can do in the year ahead as we try to liberate territory currently controlled by the Islamic State. Of course, as I think everyone in this room knows, the numbers of civilians killed by the Assad regime is many, many multiples that of the numbers of civilians killed by the Islamic State. And we could, I think, quite legitimately have many multiples of discussions about what needs to be done about the humanitarian tragedy, the insult to civilization that we call the Assad regime. But the agenda is the liberation of territory under Islamic State, for better or for worse. If you ask me, I wish we were doing something different as a nation in terms of the challenges posed by Assad. But I think our national consensus is Mosul, Raqqa, the areas under the Islamic State, that's the next set of targets. And so I think it does make sense that this discussion focus on how do we marry that military objective, liberating the territory controlled by the Islamic State, with the imperative of providing civilian protection to the people that will be liberated. What can be done that may not already be in planning? What more needs to be put on the table now to ensure that this is not just liberating territory, but freeing people and ensuring that those people, especially the vulnerable populations, the Yazidis, the Christians, and others, the vulnerable populations do not face further atrocity, do not face further heartache. So that's the agenda. Let me just ask very, very pointedly to our panelists, are there other specific things that that you think U.S. military commanders need to take account of, need to implement, or they are already implementing and deserves highlighting in our public discussion on this issue of civilian protection in territories that are now targeted for liberation?
Sure. Thanks very much. First of all, I want to underscore what you said about Syria. According to the UN, it's a 9-to-1 ratio. If it's only that, then we have a lot of other problems on our hands, too. I also want to underscore something Naomi said, and maybe even take it a step farther, when you said that terrorism or counterterrorism and atrocity prevention go hand in hand. I'd say they're more than that. They're one and the same. This is terrorism of the worst kinds being perpetrated against populations at home. It's not blowing up a metro in a Western capital, and it doesn't get on the news, but it is terrorism and terrorizing society in the worst possible way. And so it's more than hand in glove. It is something that deserves the exact same amount of attention. Rob, to answer your question, I would just say that there are two pieces to this. One is what more needs to be done to protect civilian populations in recently liberated areas. But I'd take it a step earlier, too, and recognizing that military planners are going to make most of their decisions based on strategic hilltops and poorly defended areas that are targets of opportunity and all the types of military determinations that help us figure out, you know, where we can defeat our enemy, we also need to weave into this consideration about particularly vulnerable populations, not just places where our adversary may be weak and therefore ripe for attack, but places where there are populations that need protection and maybe our adversary is weak and therefore that's why we attack there. Or maybe they're not weak and there's just a population that really needs our support. You know, long before the United States got involved in any significant way in the military fight, the president had said, you know, we're not going to get in. And then we said, well, we'll get in if we can do, you know, humanitarian things at minimal cost, referring to airdrops to the Yazidis in particular. And then it was expanded to protecting diplomats in Baghdad and Erbil. And it was this very slow expansion of the mission. But it wasn't as well thought out as it might have been. And if there is a humanitarian crisis that deserves and warrants our intervention, and unfortunately I think there are many now, then sometimes it has to be done in a way without the caveat of at minimal cost. So here we are. We're now very much involved in the fight. And I think there are opportunities for us to help very, very vulnerable communities. And so we should be weaving this into our military objectives earlier on. And then in terms of the civilian protection, I think we need to put in place as part of policy that what happens, you know, what's the playbook? We go in, we clean and clear an area. We put in place military or local law enforcement or whatever it is to deal with the stragglers, the people that take off uniforms, if they ever wore uniforms, and hide back into society. But then what do we do? What type of NGOs, what type of other government support shouldn't only be the United States, goes in specifically to help rebuild these communities, to document the atrocities that did happen, to find the mass graves, to interview the people. What the Holocaust Museum did, what the UN did that was most useful for academics like us is to be able to come back from these trips and say, we interviewed 3,600, whatever it was, people. This is critically important, and it's not part of the plan right now. So unless the Holocaust Museum does it or the UN, this is not being done systematically. And we need to get that type of intelligence, not in the classified sense, but information, so that we can identify what's happening and, frankly, get a better sense of what could be happening next.
Planning for the day after in these areas seems to be a black hole in the U.S. government, and I've heard everything from we've actually got massive efforts underway, and I know you can roll your eyes a little bit given our experiences in Iraq and Afghanistan, but at least some people have said that, all the way up to people who were going out to have key positions on the State Department side saying, we really haven't looked into this in enough detail. Much of it begins with the simple question of, are we going to have boots on the ground? Now, boots on the ground can be whole brigades or divisions, or it can be special forces, 12 men or women now, A-teams, out there with Iraqi counterterrorism troops or local militias or whatever. Because when you have U.S. forces on the ground, that is a game changer in terms of several things. First of all, we then see what's going on. Secondly, typically by having forces on the ground who can bring that magic in any conflict, immediate and decisive and devastating air power, you have a certain ability to leverage your skill sets, i.e. calling in air, and the fact that you're on the ground in a dangerous area right up front with these people, you're in a good position to make helpful suggestions. And by and large, and I don't want to overplay this, as I said before, because I've seen it go the other way very badly. In immediate post-combat situations, various local forces often are all happy to see Americans in particular, but international forces and international presence. It makes them think that there is some limit to a winner-take-all with ethnic cleansing and everything coming the next day. So it's very important to have that. That's the most important thing. Along with that comes the planning. And, of course, the more that we're committed to putting at least some people on the ground, the more we're likely to do the planning and levy the resources. It's a huge effort because, as I said, it has to be integrated with the relief to some degree. Again, you have to be careful the day after scenarios and everything else. Using NGOs, if you don't have a lot of people in there, is important. It's one thing that we did in Tikrit. The USIP did some work up there on trying to mediate between the Shia and the Sunnis. They'd had a lot of experience in Iraq. And if you can put your own people in, do something like that. And again, rely on the UN, rely on regional organizations. I'll stop there.
Thank you. Naomi?
I think I'm just going to quickly start by taking a step back, which is that in general, we need to shift away. There was a reference to the airstrikes that were done on Mount Sinjar, which without a doubt did help to save lives. But we need to move away from ad hoc responses in moments where we think because of the alignment of the constellation of the stars, we can respond in that one case. And we need to be trying to make it much more systematic, which was why before I was emphasizing identification of early warning signs, motivations of perpetrators, vulnerabilities of communities, protection strategies or gaps that exist, and trying to develop strategies, prevention strategies that respond to that. What that involves from a military perspective is also the creation of doctrine around protection of civilians, which has been in the works but really needs to be given, I think, higher priority. And really, there is an urgent need at this particular point for there to be the creation of protection of civilians doctrine that puts at the heart of some of the military efforts this protection of civilians from these very types of crimes. I do want to say one quick thing also, I think, in regards to the military. I already highlighted, you know, concerns around collateral damage, and I, you know, it's an unfortunate term, but in places like Mosul, which is going to be a really real and live conversation, you know, they're anticipating potentially over 600,000 people driven from their homes in Mosul, potentially in the course of any counter-ISIL strategy there. But on the liberation side, from a military perspective, that question of physical protection, and Jim highlighted it before, in a lot of my interviews with minority communities and with individuals, they talked about a sense of relative safety between 2009 and 2011. And I do want to underscore there were horrific atrocity crimes that were committed during that time period in Nineveh, but that for the most part, people did feel a certain degree of safety because of the joint monitoring units that Jim outlined, and that as a result, many of the communities are seeking some form of physical protection to feel safe in order to be able to return. And though ideally they seek international protection, there are many iterations through which one could examine and identify strategies for providing that physical protection for a particular period of time that could incorporate potentially government Iraq and KRG forces in the course of doing so. But from the military's perspective, there's also the question around training forces, local forces on the ground to adhere to international human rights standards, which speaks to the issue I raised before about concerns around reprisal killings and concerns around the need for reconciliation. But I'm going to touch on two things, one where I do think the military has a role and one where I have to say that this conversation has to be about more than just the military in terms of what a counter-ISIL strategy looks like. But on the military side, I think Matt mentioned, you know, we have for the past year and a half either known that there was going to be areas that have been liberated and that there would be mass graves, or we've actually had mass graves that have been exposed for that time period, yet there's been very little done to protect them or to document what happened to not just minority communities, but all of those who were attacked by the Islamic State. And that's one very tangible role that the U.S. government, other foreign governments can play, which is to preserve and collect evidence for the purpose of possibly future prosecutions or other forms of transitional justice, but also to really be able to document what happened to help restore dignity to these communities that were affected, but to also signal, especially to minority communities, that they are being taken seriously, their needs are being taken seriously, their expectation for justice through a formal mechanism is being met. And the military can play a role in that. We have seen in other situations, in Iraq in the past, in Afghanistan, forensic teams being deployed to do that type of work, but it requires the dedication of particular resources to do that. It also requires a prioritization to send people to areas that are perceived to be at risk, both military and non-military civilian officials. And I just want to quickly highlight, I think that that's a really critical point. You need to be able to send civilians, you need to be able to send non-military U.S. staff and others to areas like Sinjar to be able to better identify for themselves what are the unique threats that particular communities face, what are the needs that they have. But I just want to pivot and just say that I hope that part of this conversation will also focus on the non-military response that has to be part of the counter-ISIL strategy. Because the drivers that allowed for the emergence of the Islamic State require addressing, and the strategies to address those to ensure that we don't see the rise of a new extremist entity, we don't see future perpetrators. It will have to involve tackling some of those underlying drivers. And when we talk about stabilization, there's a whole host of activities that would fall within that that don't require the military but do require heavy and sustained engagement from the international community. And I think that's where, you know, part of the conversation has to move, because the fatigue that the international community, I think, has felt about long-term engagement in Iraq is very real. And we have to find a way to tackle that and to show the importance of making the investment in non-military strategies for preventing atrocities as well.
Okay, very good. Thank you. Let me open up the floor to your questions. If you can kindly wait for the microphone to come to you, identify yourself, and it would be helpful if you targeted the question to one of our panelists so we can get a lot more questions in. We'll start on the left over here. Yes, please.
Christina Olney with In Defense of Christians. Firstly, thank you to the Washington Institute for Near East Policy for hosting a timely and important conversation, and especially to the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum for their excellent report, which was well received by everyone who's been following this issue. My question is for Naomi. What is your assessment of the prospects for judicial accountability for the crimes committed by ISIS, and specifically for a referral to the ICC?
Please.
Thank you for that question. And I think it's important to, you know, just start by framing it from the perspective of almost everyone that I interviewed, irrespective of what their background was. They or their family members, and that's true for certain people in the room here too, have been the victims of gross human rights violations in Iraq, and for which there's been almost no accountability. So the culture of impunity is just so deep, and it is one of the drivers of conflict that we identified, which is one reason why we think it's so critical for there to be an investment in investigations right now as a starting point to lead to accountability. In regards to the ICC, I think politically it will be very challenging to see an ICC referral. I think there's going to be a lot of challenges in terms of getting something like that through the UN Security Council because of concerns, not just of Russia and China, but even, for example, the U.S. government may have towards a referral in this particular case. And, of course, Iraq is also not party to the Rome Statute, which is yet another avenue that could be pursued to encourage them to do that. There is, of course, the space for there to be domestic prosecutions in Iraq or in the KRG. Both entities currently don't have the legal provisions to be able to actually prosecute someone for genocide, so we have to create those laws, which is a challenge. There is the possibility to try people, including people like Sayef, for genocide in third parties, and I think we may actually more likely see a genocide case against the Islamic State in places like the United States or Germany or elsewhere where we see foreign fighters and other fighters coming than we will see happen in the near future through the through the International Criminal Court or through the creation of international tribunal. The urgency right now is to document, gather, preserve evidence, because we are losing that race at this particular time with mass graves that are unexposed and with survivors of atrocities migrating around the world, making it harder to kind of track them down and identify what happened. The bare minimum, an investigation, an international independent investigation, is what should have been the kind of automatic response to a designation of genocide. It's the clearest obligation within the Genocide Convention is one to punish and to punish perpetrators.
Once again, this is an extremely sensitive issue. And you have to do both, stabilize an area and persecute those who've committed crimes. To the extent that you can split the two in terms of responsibilities and time, you're going to be more likely to succeed in both. And I would argue the first priority is keeping both the people out there protecting civilians alive and the civilians. Again, I gave the example of Holbrook in Bosnia. Number of NATO troops killed in internal conflict after they went in of the 60,000, zero. Number of U.S. troops killed in the first year after we went into Iraq because the U.S. military was directly involved and certainly implicated in what people on the losing side thought was the mass punishment of people in the Ba'athist Party for atrocities which actually involved hundreds of thousands of deaths among particularly Shia and Kurds, were in the thousands. And that is something to keep in mind.
Naomi, you wanted to have another word, but can you also just complete the circle and explain why you think, to people who might not understand all the background here, why would these governments be opposed to pursuing legal proceedings against the Islamic State? It's what do we owe the Islamic State? why are we scared of this?
That's a great question. I just wanted to quickly follow up with one thing, because the Bosnia case did kind of remind me of this. What's really unique in this particular regard, and it's something that creates more space on the accountability part, is that we're not facing a situation where there's peace versus justice debate. This is a non-state actor that, as you just highlighted, no one wants to protect. So what we need to do is find a way to allocate resources, which I believe do exist, but they just need to be prioritized for this purpose, to investigate and document, while at the same time putting as much pressure in a constructive way, working with the government of Iraq and the Kurdish regional government to do the type of investigatory work that we're talking about. On the ICC side, there's a host of reasons why different actors would be uncomfortable potentially with an ICC referral. I mean, there's a fundamental distrust that certain governments have towards the ICC. But in this particular case as well, there are questions that would arise around, for example, the scope of a referral. Are we talking about crimes that have been committed throughout Iraq? And if that's the case, then it's more challenging to potentially limit it. It's been done before, but essentially there would be concerns about culpability and responsibility of the government of Iraq for crimes perpetrated by their forces or by Shia-aligned security forces. There could be concerns even, for example, potentially KRG officials could be concerned about their security forces. There is concerns about actions by potentially U.S. military in Iraq. These are all, I'm not kind of weighing in on whether or not they're legitimate or not, but these are all factors that contribute to certain individuals perhaps being uncomfortable with the idea of a broad ICC referral. One of the things that we think can be done and should be done is, again, the creation of this international independent investigation that could be mandated by the UN Security Council to look at a very narrow subset of crimes. Genocide is the crime of all crimes. Ethnic cleansing and crimes against humanity are incredibly dire. The consequences are extreme in this particular case. And having something that's more time-limited and temporally limited in terms of crimes perpetrated in Nineveh between June to August of 2014 is a first step. Of course, there has to be accountability for crimes committed throughout Iraq, but we have to start somewhere, and we need to send a signal very soon. And as I mentioned before, you know, part of this is there may be potential deterrent value to this action for local perpetrators, for foreign fighters who are considering supporting the Islamic State, the idea that they could be held responsible for genocide, it may serve as a deterrent factor. It's more than just a symbolic act at this particular point. There's many reasons why we have to be prioritizing accountability as a prevention strategy as well.
Okay, thank you. Yes, sir, in the back center.
Herbert Regenbogen, Touro Law Center. The Department of Justice has a unit headed up by Eli Rosenbaum. What is preventing the U.S. government, with all of its declaration of genocide, to mandate this unit to actively prosecute such criminals?
I'm not sure any of us are in a position to answer that, but
that's a mad question.
Matt, you want to?
No, I'll just direct you to Alan up here in front, who was in that unit and could answer it in great detail. But
well, they have to be in the United States, and they're involved with deportation of people in the United States, so it doesn't really apply.
But you can take the floor now to ask your question.
Well, my question is primarily
Right. Take the mic, though, Alan.
Oh, sorry. My question is primarily for Naomi or anyone else. You know, I'm really intrigued about using the term genocide to deal with a terrorist phenomenon, but I'm also troubled by doing so. As Matt knows, I was involved in a case against, and he participated as an expert against the Arab Bank for allowing homicide, suicide bombers to function. We represented the families of the victims, and we claimed that they were the victims of genocidal terrorism. And it was a new term that was used in the courts for the first time. And we were successful. We had problems jurisdictionally, but we were successful. So I like the idea, but what I'm worried about is how do you really, it's difficult to prove because you have war crimes, which we know about. We have crimes against humanity, which is like a war crime. But genocide rises to a different level where it has to be perpetrated for the purpose of destroying a group or an entity as such. So can you tell me about the evidence that you have with Nineveh or elsewhere that, that this was actually the intent of ISIS to really destroy an entire group?
Please.
I mean, I'll touch very briefly, and I'm going to do something slightly tacky, which is refer you to the report, which I think is
less tacky. I will refer you to the report,
which I think is available at the back of the room, right back there in that corner, because we do go into a more detailed analysis and highlight some of the things that Matt mentioned before in terms of stated intent that we've seen from Dabiq and elsewhere. But our report really focused on the specific targeting, and by looking at patterns of targeting different communities, massacres, the purpose for women being being kidnapped, there is a considerable amount of evidence in that can be pulled together. Of course, any case on genocide is incredibly difficult to build and to successfully prosecute. For a whole host of reasons. What we're interested in doing, and we want the report to compel an effort to invest resources and accountability, but what we really want to also do is prompt that conversation about what can we do in advance so that we don't get to the stage where we have to tackle the challenges of prosecuting these particular cases. There are communities that are at risk today of atrocity crimes, either continued atrocity crimes or the potential risk in the future of them. And I think that's one of the reasons why, you know, we're really keen to, I think as Matt said, it show that there is not just a mutually reinforcing, but as you said, it is the same goals. Because once we've gotten to the point that we're building cases, we've essentially, we've to a certain degree failed. It means we failed to prevent the occurrence of these crimes. And I believe strongly that the prosecution of these cases and transitional justice efforts more broadly can help for a recurrence. But I think we have to, because of the current counter-ISIL strategy that's underway right now, be talking a bit about the protection of these particular minorities from future threats as well.
But atrocity crimes is one thing. How do you go to the second level of saying the entire group was target for extinction?
So, again, kind of outlined in the report are a couple of key things. So, we saw, I'm going to highlight just for example with the Yazidi community, which is a community that we focused on, you saw the intentional, so encircling of, under the Genocide Convention, there's a number of different acts. You saw, for example, the intentional encircling of Mount Sinjar and the deprivation of food, medical assistance, water to the Yazidi community that was on the mountain. In the interviews that I did, when people would try to get off the mountain, they would be attacked by the Islamic State. You saw in places like Kocho, Harden, other locations where there had been massacres, the separation of men and women and the murder of the male population, the enslavement of the female population, their forced conversion, and then enslavement for sexual slavery by them. You have numerous kind of documented accounts, public accounts, private accounts, where you have senior Islamic State leaders indicating that this particular community, again, the Yazidi community, simply cannot exist. They should not exist. They should be destroyed. That they even exist today is a failure of past efforts to eliminate this particular community. So there's a couple of, in terms of, you know, killing, creating environments that kind of deprive the sustenance of life, preventing births, all of those strategies, unfortunately, we saw play out in terms of the Islamic State's crimes. And I'm just using one particular example in this particular case. But again, the report goes into far greater detail. And again, I just want to highlight that the Islamic State was doing this intentional targeting of minority communities more largely to advance strategies around controlling, exterminating, and expelling populations to help them expand their control throughout the region.
And of course, it's not just the important work of the Holocaust Museum. The U.S. government has issued a formal declaration of genocide. Yes, in the back in the corner. Yes, sir.
My name is Tai Badri, Iraqi monitor. I have three comments over whatever the gentleman asked about Yazidis. In Iraq, we have three different problems. First, between Muslim society and Yazidi society. Yazidis believe in devil and evil as a good person. Muslim society, they said no, he's a bad person, first. And this starts from the parliament. First assembling in the parliament, when they recite the name of the God inside the parliament, Yazidis said, don't say bad things about evil. That's the first thing. Second, between Muslim society by themselves. People believe in Ali as their God, and Sunni believe in Omar as their God. And since the government belongs to the Shiites, if you don't believe in Ali's, that means you don't deserve benefit from the government, jobs, whatever. Third, between the village far away from Baghdad cities, which is, she's mentioned, Yazidi's area.
I'm going to have to ask you to just make a turn this into a question really quickly, please.
Ty.
No, can you turn this into a question very quickly?
Last point is, between Yazidi's area especially, between the people who live in the downtown, for a long time they took good benefits from the central governments, and the people surround this government, surround these villages. So they, when the time come, the regime turn over, they take revenge from the people who live inside the villages, which is Yazidis by themselves, and tribes, which is surround them. ISIS, my question is, Islamic State, the key of shut down Islamic State, it's a Baghdad regime. Baghdad regime allow Islamic States to occupy cities like Samarra for 5 hours and Mosul until now. Thank you.
All right, Jim, what is the connection between the government in Baghdad?
Yeah, the connection is one of incompetence. The Iraqi government, the last thing it wanted was for ISIS to take a third of the country. But its policies, its procedures, its level of competence, corruption, and the lack of morale among its military led to that. But I wouldn't read into that anything deliberate.
Okay, thank you. Yes, in front, please. Microphone right in front.
Thank you so much for the opportunity. And I'm Yazidi, by the way, from Yazidi Relief Fund. Thank you so much for highlighting our religion and our faith, which is one of the reasons that we won't be able to exist in that region. So as it's been mentioned, that genocide is ongoing and will keep on going. We as a Yazidi minority in that region, we lost trust in Baghdad as well as in KRG. So we're looking for Canton or Green Zone or something. Is it possible to create? Or if it is, how can we achieve that? Because that's the main reason why people want to leave. And a lot of people don't have any finances to leave. So some of them have to go back and right. They will face this.
So when you think about the long term, what can be done? What creative ideas can be done when U.S. forces aren't there, when foreign forces aren't there to ensure that a group like the Yazidis has protection?
Very quickly, the Yazidis were protected, as I think your surveys indicated, in that period of time before ISIS appeared on the scene. The thing you're asking for, and it's very hard, and I've been doing this since the 1980s with groups, Syrianis and Chalcedonians in eastern Turkey. It's very hard to try to reassure groups who are minorities in that part of the world, that something like ISIS or the Assad regime isn't going to appear, or that if it appears, the United States / international community will act quick enough against it. I couldn't make that statement.
Any other comments?
I wish there was something more you could say, but that's the reality.
I mean, I'll just quickly say, I mean, your question essentially begs the question, can we reverse the effects of ethnic cleansing? Can we reverse the effects in which you have an entire community and sets of communities that have been driven from their homes? And I think that's incredibly difficult to forecast, because I think one of the problems that we have seen happen in Iraq and that's happened elsewhere is, you know, rather than, you know, kind of hoping for the best and planning for the worst, we always essentially just plan for the best outcome. And we tend to we don't look at a government's capacity realistically. And insofar as that, I mean whether or not the government of Iraq or the KRG has the capacity to actually provide the types of protection you're talking about, legal protection, physical protection for these particular communities. And I think what we have to do is be very stark today about what some of the limitations are, because they're facing immense challenges on many, many fronts. Which is why I think there will have to be some sort of a role for the international community in this particular regard. And that's not very popular, potentially, to say, but these communities do face legitimate threats, and we do have to be talking about physical security. I also think, though, we have to be talking, and again, this goes back to the importance of kind of forecasting potential risks, we have to be thinking about, are there additional or new communities that are going to face vulnerabilities as a result of liberation? And by that I mean including parts of the Sunni Arab community as well, in areas where they've been driven from their homes too. And how do we provide protection to them? How do we prioritize the kind of reconciliation and bringing together these communities, who now the level of distrust is so incredibly high, because people do feel that their neighbors were complicit in the crimes that were perpetrated against them. And in some cases, it's not feel, they know. So we have to be thinking today about not just the military strategies, but the non-military strategies that will help to ensure that we can, in some semblance, stabilize these particular areas.
Yes, on the far right, please. Thank you. Naomi.
Hello, my name is Delia with the Nineveh Council of America. Mosul, which was Iraq's religious and culture, which had so much cultural and religious diversity, and which has effectively been cleansed by Daesh, you'll find that in the city, there men and women have been complicit with Daesh. So what can be done to stabilize the population that has been living with Daesh, and, you know, in order to build the trust of reintegrating minority displaced communities?
I don't know why you're all looking at me. I don't know the answer to that. I hope that people are thinking about this now, even though Mosul is not going to be liberated tomorrow. We need to be thinking about this. Mosul is going to be the hardest nut to crack, because it's been the de facto capital in Iraq for the Islamic State. It has been completely under their control. It's for us a completely denied space. You have, all the way at the extreme, you have children who have been completely desensitized to violence. How you, and it's the larger picture of how you, you know, how you rebuild from scratch, not from zero, but from negative, how you rebuild society is going to be a monumental question. And as I listen to all of these questions, at the end of the day, we need to remember, whatever happens, if we snapped our fingers and Daesh was gone and Assad was gone and there was political rehabilitation and balance within the Iraqi political system, you can't wash away the memory of what we'll be dealing with for decades now, which is the remnants of the sectarian hatred, the complicity of neighbors, the concerns about reprisal attacks, and putting that, there is no silver bullet to putting any of this back together. But it's why it's so critically important, as Naomi said earlier, for us to be thinking not only about the military components to all of this. You know, you can't go in and defeat Saddam Hussein and then realize, wait a minute, I don't have a plan for putting this country back together. The lesson now is we can't go in and defeat the Islamic State and liberate Mosul and then say, wait a minute, we're here. What do we do with this very, very angry population, angry at each other, having lost, you know, years of education? These are things that people who are smarter than I am and who focus on these things on a regular basis need thinking about. All I can tell you is this needs to be an area of tremendous focus.
I would just kind of underscore that particular point and maybe just share a couple of quick anecdotes. What I thought was really interesting in interviewing those who had been displaced from Mosul was speaking with a number of Christian men who said that they had sent their families away to Karakosh, but they had stayed in Mosul. And when I asked why they stayed, it was interesting. They said that in part they actually thought that maybe life under the Islamic State would actually be more stable than what they had been experiencing in Mosul with, you know, many Shia militias and just a general sense of insecurity and persecution that they had felt. And I thought it was so interesting insofar as what that said about the vulnerabilities, the insecurities, the political realities of Mosul, Nineveh, of Iraq more broadly. And of course, sadly, you know, they were driven from their homes under unbelievably difficult circumstances, forced to leave. Otherwise, they would essentially be killed. So, you know, for the local communities, there are local communities who welcomed the Islamic State for a host of different reasons, and that will be challenging, as Matt said, to unravel, because that in part means addressing a lot of the drivers for why there was support for the Islamic State in the first place. In 2011, the poverty level in Nineveh was 27% of the population lived below the poverty line. The poverty line is $2.5. That's just one small example when we talk about the hurdles that will exist in trying to rebuild an area and develop an area in which diverse cultures can thrive. What I'm very deeply concerned about is the fatigue that has persisted and that has emerged, in some cases for good reason, in Iraq over the years will mean that we will not prioritize the investment in a non-military strategy for stabilizing these areas and rebuilding it, and that we will punt that responsibility, when I say we, I mean the governments involved in the counter-ISIL strategy, punt it to the UN, which will not have the capacity or the ability to do the type of work that is required in this particular case.
Okay, two last brief questions. Yes, sir. And in front, if you could make your questions brief and pointed, and then we will conclude our event.
Thank you. My name is Vern Liebel. I'm from Center for Advanced Operational Culture and Learning down at Marine Corps University. I'm the Middle East Desk Officer there. You keep talking a lot about military planning and then talk about the civilian side. Got that. Military side. I brief Marines, soldiers, sailors, airmen all the time, down at infantry level, special forces, whatever. You keep talking about planning. I'm asking, what planning are you talking about? Because there is no operational planning. There is no tactical planning going on. There is very little strategic level planning. Okay, so what are you talking about? And the corollary to that is, how do we prepare our military forces if we insert them there? Because law, land, warfare, and all that training, where are the POW camps? Mm-hmm. There aren't any. Mm-hmm. This is like fighting the Japanese in World War II, and atrocities are going to happen by U.S. troops if we're committed there, because that's the nature of the Islamic State. So what are you talking about?
Yeah.
Okay. Wait, Jim, hold on just 1 second. Yes, sir. Right in front.
My name is Hemen Hosseini with the Washington Kurdish Institute. I have a question for Ambassador James Jeffrey. The days after the Sinjar's takeover by ISIS, the only force who made a human corridor to save thousands of trapped Yazidis on Sinjar, Mount Sinjar, were the Syrian Kurdish People's Protection Units, which weren't mentioned today, unfortunately. And after that, they made further steps by establishing local Yazidi fighter units, Sinjar Protection Units, which is composed of hundreds of local Yazidi women and men. So for the first time in history, Yazidis are armed to defend themselves, to fight for their existence. And like Naomi said, Yazidis have lost trust in Masoud Barzani and his Peshmergas, given that at the most critical moments, they abandoned them. Okay, so my question is this. My specific question. Do you think Sinjar's protection resistance units, who are hundreds of local Yazidis, do you think they deserve to be supported directly by the United States militarily, financially, and politically?
Okay, Jim.
The United States is not supporting anybody directly but the Iraqi government. The question is, should the United States provide support through the Iraqi government to these local units? Absolutely. We are trying to do that in Nineveh and with some of the Sunni Arabs and others, and the Yazidis have every bit as much right to do that as anybody else. To the other issue, there's definitely doctrine, there's stability doctrine in the U.S. military. It has a prominent place in the recent, 23-4 or 4-23, the counterinsurgency manual that the U.S. Army and the Marine Corps put together. But the details of who the military knows how to plan almost anything, including relief operations, civilian treatment. They haven't gotten a real order to do that in great detail because the thing is kicked over not only to the Iraqi government with some reason, but also to the quote Geneva process in terms of Syria. So we're trying to avoid that, which is, as I said earlier, a mistake. Secondly, there's often a problem in who to plug into on the Department of State / USAID side. That's a huge, big issue. The point is there are nodes to plug into, but the highest levels of government have to decide, if I can use an electronics thing, which plug to use to plug into them and who turns the switches on and off. That isn't automatic in our government. That has to be decided as part of the whole mission statement by essentially the White House, that mission statement, and the decision on how the things all plug together has not been made. If the White House makes that decision, there are people capable of carrying it out.
And just a final comment, which is exactly what I little gurgle of talk there. I wanted to close on this, which is this very important and stimulating, provocative, and somewhat scary discussion is occurring in a political environment. As important and urgent as this entire discussion, I think we should recognize that the political environment is many light years away from the sort of urgent conversation that we're talking about today. If anything, it is the exact opposite. It is how to do the business and leave as quickly as possible with whatever civilian protection, most likely being a victim of that speedy exit. Mm-hmm. And so I believe that we collectively have a lot more to do to press this conversation on this is a bipartisan comment, is to press this conversation on both Republican and Democratic political leaders, because it will be something that comes back to haunt us regardless of who's in the White House next January. Thank you all very much. Thank you for joining us for today's discussion.